My topic of presentation is cervicogenic dizziness. So this disorder, it's mainly when patients comes, most of the times we are not in a position to diagnose these cases definitely. It's basically diagnosis by exclusion. You have to exclude other probable causes and see what things are there that can help us to diagnose the condition of cervicogenic dizziness. Have a look at the inputs to the vestibular nuclei that maintain balance. One is definitely from the vestibular system. Then we have inputs from proprioceptors of the cervical joints and muscles. And we have input from the visual system as well. So this signifies the importance of the cervical region in maintaining balance. And moving on to the diagnosis part or more details about cervicogenic dizziness as such. Usually patients doesn't present with true vertigo symptoms, that is, they don't present with true rotatory symptoms of giddiness. Generally, the complaints, what they say, will be like imbalance or disequilibrium or a vague kind of dizzy feeling. And another important aspect is the symptoms, what they present, will be provoked by head movements or certain positions. So this we have to check whether the symptoms what they say or complaints what they say is provoked by head movements or positions. And usually they present with neck pain or stiffness in the neck region. So these are the main complaints that the patient can say that can prime us or that can make us to think in terms of a cervicogenic dizziness patient. What causes cervicogenic dizziness? It's mainly the dysfunction of upper cervical joint receptors or deep cervical muscles. Dysfunction at those region. So if there is a dysfunction there, it will result in perturbation of information from sensory afferents in the cervical spine. The information that goes from the cervical spine will be disturbed. Patients presenting with neck injury, you have this cervico-ocular reflexes that will be exaggerated in such patients. And when we examine the patients, we can even see nystagmus being manifested with the head fixed and body turned maneuvers. Other two important reflexes, the vestibulocolic and cervicocolic reflexes, which are important to stabilize the head in space. These reflexes actually lead to excessive neck muscle activity when the patient is experiencing a vestibular imbalance. And it's a vicious cycle wherein this excessive neck muscle activity exacerbates their dizziness, which in turn exacerbates their neck discomfort. Now moving on to the diagnostic process for cervicogenic dizziness. These are the five important aspects which we should keep in mind. What is the dizziness complaint the patient is presenting? Whether it is a true rotatory complaint, then it doesn't go with a cervicogenic dizziness diagnosis. Usually it will be non-rotatory. And they will be presenting with vague imbalance. Next one, eliminate other causes for dizziness or unsteadiness. Whether we are able to arrive at any other diagnosis through our symptomatology or through our investigations, whether we are able to arrive at any other particular type of disorder. The patient will have neck pain or stiffness, and their dizziness will be provoked by cervical movements. And of course, these physical tests, the range of motion exercises, cervical signs on palpation, balance, and Dix-Hallpike test can give us definite information regarding cervicogenic dizziness case. moving on to each one, dyspnea characteristics, it must be consistent with cervicogenic dyspnea, unsteadiness, imbalance, disequilibrium, and you have to exclude the other types of dyspnea. And we have to dig in detail what is the dyspnea behavior the patient is manifesting, what is the onset, severity, frequency, duration, etc. You have to, of course, eliminate other causes like stroke, spinal cord pathology, cerebellar ataxia, or Parkinson's disease. Most important aspect, presence of neck pain or stiffness. Whether the patient has neck pain, discomfort, stiffness. Some patients might present with headache also. The below given are the less common complaints, radiculopathy, earfulness, sweating, tinnitus, etc. You have to ask the history of the pain behavior also, how it started, what is the duration, frequency, when it aggravates and when it eases. Provocation of dyspnea by neck movements. Their general condition of unsteadiness or poor balance will be exacerbated by cervical movements or certain positions, usually extension or rotation. Otherwise, when the patient is attempting to look towards either side, they can present with complaints of disequilibrium. Physical examination, range of motion, palpation of tissues, balance, smooth pursuit, neck torsion test, and Dix-Hallpike maneuver. Then types of injuries that can lead to cervicogenic dyspnea, people involved in accidents, flexion extension injuries, arthritis patients, herniated disc, trauma to head. Differential diagnosis, we should differentially diagnose cervicogenic dyspnea from these conditions, whether the case is a BPPV case, VBI case, migraine, or cardiovascular dyspnea. I will present one or two cases where we have diagnosed this condition. Can you just go back? Yeah, full screen. Let's be here. We had actually 4 or 5 cases diagnosed as cervicogenic dyspnea. Among these two cases, after diagnosis, they went to the physical therapy management and they had definite relief from symptoms. The first case, a 40-year-old male, he had history of on and off giddiness for 4 years. It was not true rotatory. Used to last for 5 minutes. Giddiness was primarily noticed while turning head to right. His CT and MRI of the brain taken 1 year back was reportedly normal. And by doing VNG, we got abnormality only in these conditions. One was spontaneous in dark testing condition, we asked the patient to turn to right and there was a right and downbeating nystagmus elicited. Dix-Hallpike right, in sit head right position, he was again eliciting that right beating nystagmus. Video. This is the right beating nystagmus that we got in Dix-Hallpike right testing condition. Yes, 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 in the sitting position. Yeah, escape. Go to the slide. The second case, a 40-year-old male, his complaint was recurrent episodes of giddiness, again not true rotatory, lightheadedness while turning to either sides since 4 months, used to last for hours, occurred once in a week, mainly while looking up, and associated imbalance while walking since 4 months. History of neck pain 1 year back with restricted neck movements and aching pain from neck to upper part of the scapula. This case came for VNG evaluation. And in this case also, in the Dix-Hallpike right, sit head right, we could get a definite right beating nystagmus. Similarly, on Dix-Hallpike left, sit head left, left beating nystagmus. This case, we diagnosed it as a probable case of cervicogenic dizziness. And after that, they went for MRI of the cervical spine. And there was degenerative changes in cervical spine with a diffuse disc bulge at C5-6, C6, C7 level. So this patient also responded very well for physical therapy. There were one or two other cases, but we don't have the data of what happened after the physical therapy management. Of course, the diagnosis of this condition is how they respond to the physical therapy also is important. Can go to slide. Now, moving on to the treatment or management, mainly it is a physical therapy management using collars. What the advice given is, the patient should have the opportunity to move the neck muscles also so that they don't lose the muscle strength and continue to stimulate neck proprioception. Basically, physical therapy to improve range of motion of neck and to reduce neck muscle spasm and discomfort. So these are the different physical therapy techniques, and you can say that prompt favorable response to manual therapy treatment helps to identify this condition also. It reconfirms that the diagnosis what we made was right. So I'm not going into much details. These exercises also help for cervicogenic dizziness. Balance or tandem balance, eyes open and closed, and the oculomotor impairments, eye follow, gaze stability exercises, eye and head coordination exercises, etc. So with that, I will conclude. Now basically, from our side, I am in an audiology department. So, where we diagnose, we refer the cases to physical medicine and rehab. From there, they take up basically with such cases. For a cervicogenic dizziness, they put them on medicines as well as they suggest them the exercises.